Welcome to the 1600 Sessions. I'm Stewart McLaurin, President of the White House Historical Association. 2021 marks the 60th anniversary of the association, founded by First Lady Jacqueline Kennedy in 1961. We'll be revisiting that history throughout the year and how our work at the association has evolved to serve our mission of education and preservation. One of the earliest and most important projects that the association took on was the creation of the first White House guidebook, also spearheaded and inspired by Mrs. Kennedy. But this is something that we did not do alone. It was in partnership with another great organization in Washington, D.C., located about four blocks away from our offices on Lafayette Square, and that's the National Geographic Society. Today, we'll be relating the remarkable story of how that guidebook came about in just a few months from conception to publication, and the heroic efforts of National Geographic photographers and staff that made it happen. We'll be hearing the actual voice of someone who was there from the beginning, and that's Robert Breeden, known to all as Bob Breeden. Bob was an assistant illustrations editor at National Geographic in 1961 when he was asked by the Society's president, Melville Bell Grosvenor, to produce the first official guidebook for the White House. Bob Breeden would have a long and distinguished career at the National Geographic and would go on to serve the White House Historical Association, launching our journal, which is now White House History Quarterly, serving on our board for more than two decades, and he also served as our chairman and CEO. He retired in 2001 and continued to serve on our board until he passed away in 2013. We're fortunate that we can hear from Bob Breeden himself, from an oral history recorded by the National Geographic Society. And to guide us through that story today, we're pleased to welcome the National Geographic's Renee Braden. Renee is the Senior Director of Library and Archives at the National Geographic Society. And in 1997, Renee interviewed Bob Breeden for the oral history that we'll be discussing today. We'll be talking about the creation of that historic guidebook, but we'll also be talking about the long and important partnership between the National Geographic Society, the White House, and the White House Historical Association. Thank you so much for joining us today, Renee.
Thank you, Stuart. It's good to be here.
Well, let's start by learning how that oral history with Bob Breeden came about. And I should point out that although your two names have some similarity, there's no relationship between the two of you.
That's right. Thanks, Stuart. So Braden and Breeden sound quite a bit alike, especially when I was a new employee at National Geographic and people thought that we might be related. I jokingly, throughout the interview that we're going to hear today, I called him Uncle Bob a few times just to remind him of that. Of course, I was very junior and he was very senior, so it was amusing to both of us. The oral history program at National Geographic was designed to capture stories of photographers and editors and writers, our grantees and explorers, you know, all of these experiences and all of these things they have done all over the world. We could corral them towards the end of their careers, some long retired, like Bob, and get them in and do these interviews. Bob, of course, even after he retired from National Geographic, stayed very, very busy, and he was really hard to pin down, and he canceled on us a couple of times, but we managed to get him in. Bob was always interested in publishing. He grew up in Montgomery, West Virginia, and even in high school, put together a handbill campaign when President Truman was coming to visit that was very successful, and I'm sure that encouraged him in his profession. He also went to the University of Missouri, as a lot of younger editors did at National Geographic. And Bob was known to be part of what was called at National Geographic the Missouri Mafia, which was a lot of young people from the journalism school there with new ideas about publishing, about layout and design and photojournalism that would really revolutionize National Geographic. He went on to such a distinguished career at the Geographic. He expanded the publishing program with Traveler magazine, with all the kids' magazines and books, and of course the special publications and the public service projects of which the White House Guidebook was the very first one.
You know, it's really amazing to me, Renee, that prior to the Kennedy presidency, there was no guidebook for the White House. Presidents and first ladies had lived there since 1800, and Mrs. Kennedy herself had visited there with her mom, and she was really disappointed that there was no guidebook like you would get at the great American museums. In fact, until this guidebook was done, there wasn't even any extensive photography done of these beautiful rooms. I understand, though, that there was an article in National Geographic toward the end of the Eisenhower presidency, and that National Geographic President Grosvenor was instrumental in that article. I think his father was actually related to President Taft, if I'm not mistaken. But tell us what you learned from your conversation with Bob Breeden about that Eisenhower-era article that the National Geographic published.
Right. So Melville Bell Grosvenor, known around the Geographic as just MBG, a lot of people had just their initials around there, had attended a White House dinner and proposed to President and Mrs. Eisenhower that the Geographic take its very special photojournalism and its technique to do a big piece on the White House. And the Eisenhowers agreed. And of course, by the time all the photography was done and the writing, the publication date was coming very, very late in the Eisenhower administration. So the Geographic had a picture of the Nixons, a picture of the Kennedys, and in case there was some problem with the election or the publication date had to be changed at the last minute, a Christmas tree would suffice as a safe neutral. But as it turned out, they were able to finish the layout very much just in the nick of time. So the article itself appeared in the January 1961 issue. People were receiving it in mid-December in their homes. So as soon as it was ready, MBG sent 12 copies to Mrs. Kennedy as a courtesy.
I'm sure Mrs. Kennedy loved receiving a copy of the National Geographic that featured the White House, and I'm sure it probably sparked the idea of the guidebook. I think she initially wanted to do a series of postcards of the state floor rooms that visitors could purchase, and that would help fund the work of restoring the White House. But then that evolved to the idea of a guidebook. And obviously the guidebook became much more practical than postcards. But still to this day, the guidebook remains an important funding mechanism for the White House Historical Association, as well as the educational nature of this important book. So internal to the White House structure, I understand that Mrs. Kennedy went to J.B. West, who was the longtime chief usher at the White House, and to Nash Castro, who I actually had the privilege of meeting before he passed. Nash was a wonderful man, and he was instrumental in the founding of the White House Historical Association. But then they were instrumental, I understand, in connecting with the National Geographic also. What did you learn from Bob Breeden about that connection and how the relationship between the Historical Association and the White House and the National Geographic was instigated?
Well, you know, Bob tells the story that Mr. Grosvenor was approached by Conrad Wirth, who was the director of the Park Service. He was a member of the National Geographic's Board of Trustees. He was also one of the founders of the White House Historical Association. And I think, Stuart, I think we have a lot of these same names around Washington in that time. Those people cared so much about preserving the history across what is, you know, the local story, the national story, and the international story. Connie Wirth was on our board and approached MBG to work on the guidebook for Mrs. Kennedy. And I think Bob says that MBG must have agreed immediately because the work started instantly.
Well, I know that Bob talked about that first version of the guidebook, and it's incredible to me that they pulled this off in just 3 weeks' time. I just can't imagine doing that. I know that our publications today, and certainly yours as well, are months in the planning process and execution. But how in the world did they pull this off in just 3 weeks?
Well, they pulled a lot of all-nighters, I think. Bob talks about pulling together a team very, very quickly. They had to do all the layout and design. They worked with Don Crump, who also, I think, became important in the White House Historical Association. They worked with White House curator Lorraine Pierce. She wrote the text. I think their original thought was that it would look sort of like a National Geographic layout and design in the magazine. They started right after Christmas. They slammed it together in about 3 weeks. And of course, the Kennedys were just getting settled. They weren't allowed to go in the White House and just start taking more photographs. So they had to use everything that they had just, they thought they had already. And so they put together what they thought she would want, but it didn't quite turn out that way.
Well, I understand that there was a little bit of drama in getting it to Mrs. Kennedy on deadline as she wanted, and that they actually deployed a very high-tech solution, something that was cutting edge at the time called Scotch tape. Let's take a listen to what Bob had to say about that.
So after many long hours, nights and weekends, and sometimes some 24-hour days, we were ready to show the book to Mrs. Kennedy. I'd worked till about 3 o'clock one morning in order to get the book ready to show to Melville so that we could then take it to the White House. There were cars lined up in a parking lot, several cars with the motors running, and Donna and I were upstairs with the dummy. And we suddenly remembered we didn't have a copy of it. If she wanted to keep it, we didn't have anything to go by. So we raced it upstairs to the photo lab. We had put it together with what was new then, magic tape, Scotch tape. That's how it was bound together. And took it into the lab to be copied. And a man named Jimmy Craig was on the camera. It was his job to make all the dummy copies. I left with him. I told him I had to have it immediately to drop everything else. And so I went back maybe 10 minutes later to get it. And he hadn't been able to make the book lie flat. So he'd cut it apart. And of course it would lie flat then. But when I saw it, I knew all these people were waiting downstairs. I got on the phone to Howard Payne. I said, "Howard, bring the magic tape to the lab immediately. Let's put this book back together." So we did. And we took it on down to the White House.
Well, they go into the yellow oval room with Mrs. Kennedy, and you can imagine the high expectations that were awaiting them there. And she was really eager and excited to get this book going. But that presentation, I understand, did not go as planned. Tell us what Bob said to you about that meeting.
MBG, Melville Bell Grosvenor, was part of the presentation. In particular, there was this charming picture of the Kennedy children, Caroline and John John, in their bedroom. And Mr. Grosvenor, always big on the human interest in all the stories that the National Geographic told, just loved that picture, thought it was wonderful. And it had come from Look magazine originally. And he just kept saying what a lovely picture it was. And she said, "I don't really want to use that picture." And then a few minutes later, he would say, "Oh, Mrs. Kennedy, it's so charming. They're lovely children. You know, the world will really enjoy this." And she did not want it. And finally, she said to him, "Well, Dr. Grosvenor, even at the age of 2, I think a person's bedroom should be private." And he knew then there was no talking her into it. That was her final word on it. And of course, he didn't know at the time that Look was never supposed to have published it or even handed it over to the Geographic for possible use. They had worked so hard all these long nights, but only with a very small notion of what they thought she wanted. And I think it's wonderful that in the end, it was a more collaborative approach, but then the time clock started ticking over again when they had to redo the layout.
Well, that's really a wonderful story. And it's interesting to me that this was the first presidency in many presidencies where they actually had young children in the White House. And even, as you know, in recent presidencies, there's been this consideration and balance between family privacy, privacy of the children, and public exposure. And it's interesting that she was playing that out for the first time in modern times, talking about this guidebook process. So they go back to the National Geographic, go back to the drawing board, and they prepare for round 2 with Mrs. Kennedy. Tell us what we know about that, and how long did it take that round 2 to take place, and what did they have to do to get it ready to go back to her?
So they started in March, but the publication date was reset for July 4th. Wonderful day to have that as the publication date, but not really a lot of time to do it. So it was Bob and Don Crump and a photographer, Bates Littlehales, really well known mostly for underwater photography, but he was in town between assignments and he got a plum assignment to go down the street and get to work for Mrs. Kennedy. So they took all the photos. They had just 3 days. They shot on 35 millimeter. Certain pieces of furniture that were very important to Mrs. Kennedy to include. So there was quite a list, and they were trying to get it all together. At one point, they had one other photograph to get. They had Bob and Don and the White House curator, Lorraine Pierce, tiptoeing through the private residence at 10:30 in the morning. And it was clear that Mrs. Kennedy was still behind the closed doors. And they were terrified she might open the door in her nightgown. And I think there were remnants of a party the night before or something. So they were tiptoeing and whispering and sort of very conspiratorial. Thank heavens, Miss Kennedy did not open the door, maybe because she heard them. But that didn't happen. And I'm sure Bob was much relieved in the end.
That's really a great story. So while they were doing this, they were wrestling with something that we wrestle with today, and that's keeping track of what's being added to the state floors, what's on view to the public, and what's being updated in the various rooms. But even more so then, because Mrs. Kennedy was very busy, as you know, bringing in items for the collection, restoring things to these beautiful rooms that she wanted to take to a really museum standard that we really try to honor today. So I'm sure they had to deal with some very innovative, creative ways of getting this done. Any insights into that process?
That's one of the interesting things, is that Mrs. Kennedy didn't wait for the guidebook to be finished to get the money. She was calling, I think, and identifying pieces that she wanted back in the White House and in the collection, because the rooms were changing the whole time they were trying to photograph them. So there was another photographer, George Mobley, also a wildlife photographer, had been all over the world. He too was in town, and he was sent down to the White House, and he was using very, very heavy equipment, and the porters needed to help him bring it all in and out. And he shot, I think, the green room and some of the other rooms two or three times within a week or so, because a rug was switched out or a new piece of furniture was donated, and it had to all be redone again. Even though it was just down the street from headquarters, it wasn't quite the easy job that they thought it might be. Mrs. Kennedy had expressed the desire for the layout to have only vertical photographs. So that was going to be a challenge, but they would manage as best they could.
Well, it's interesting that George Mobley was a wildlife photographer. Let's listen to Bob's words about what George encountered one evening when he was doing some photography in the White House.
George Mobley was in the Queen's bedroom one evening about 6 o'clock. And he had his view camera. Almost all the work was done on 4x5 film. And he had his view camera with the black cloth over his head. And he sensed that somebody was in the room. He ducked out and looked, and it was Mrs. Kennedy. And of course, he's a little shaken. And he says, "Oh, hello there, I'm George Mobley. I've been working here for 3 months." Actually, he'd been working longer than that. But she smiled and said hello, and she said, "May I look?" And he said, "Of course." So she put her head under the black cloth. And George said that after a minute or two, she says, "Gee, it's upside down." Now, you got to remember that Jackie Kennedy was an inquiring photographer on a local newspaper. And maybe she'd never used a view camera. But after she looked at the picture that he was going to get, she said, why aren't you including this table over here?" And he, as politely as he could, said, "Well, Mrs. Kennedy, as you know, you have asked us to do nothing but vertical pictures." And she said, "You can't get that table in and have a vertical picture." She says, "Oh, well, that isn't absolutely necessary." So he turned the camera around, got the horizontal picture. And from then on, we were able, in those cases that required it, to use the horizontal picture.
And to give context, Renee, to your voice, which I think we heard in that conversation with Bob, tell us about that.
Yeah, he was pretty humorous, so I was laughing along through his stories.
And I understand, though, that they faced another challenge, and that was getting the perfect cover photograph for the guidebook. Tell us how that happened.
Yeah, so they had a number of good shots that they thought they could use, but Mrs. Kennedy insisted that she wanted the entire White House in the shot, not just an angle of the porch or something at sunset. And so they had to figure out how to get the whole exterior in the photo. So they sent, once again, George Mobley. They figured out they had to use a fire ladder on a fire truck to get the right height and distance. So they sent George to firefighting school for 3 days to learn how to use the ladder and not fall off the whole thing. They took the shot from the north side of the White House, and it was right before Easter. The tulips were in bloom. It was beautiful, but they did it in the afternoon to get the right light. So it was rush hour traffic. And Stuart, you know, rush hour traffic to watch a guy up on a ladder. And of course, people probably thought the White House was on fire, you know. So it was a bit of a scene, but they did get a beautiful picture.
So they finally got the shot that they needed, but there was one problem that involved the flowers on the North Lawn that I think is very interesting. Here we'll hear from Bob in his own words about that problem.
Before we shot the picture, Don and I had visited the White House. We saw that there were some beautiful tulips around the fountain, bright. The day before the picture was to be made, I was down at the White House with Nash Castro, and I said, Nash, they've dug up all the tulips, little scrawny geraniums out there. And he says, is that going to be a problem? I said, well, it's not going to show up as well, that's for sure. He said, well, he says, why don't I get the people in the National Park Service to bring over some potted plants? We'll just set the pots out. And I said, well, that's not going to look. So we finally told the engraver to make, they were recently planted, so they had no grass, it was mud, to make the mud green, or as green as possible, so it would appear to be grass, and to brighten the geraniums. And that's how the cover finally appeared.
And so that was an early episode of Photoshopping, I suppose, for the cover of the first guidebook. I'll tell you actually an interesting story that we just undertook. And it was the idea of Marcia Anderson, who's been our longtime, really terrific, wonderful vice president of publications at the association. Marcia has been working on the 25th edition of the guidebook, which will come out next November on our actual 60th anniversary. Well, Marcia wanted to recreate that photograph like was taken for the guidebook, the first guidebook. But now, as you know, Pennsylvania Avenue is actually closed, and the permitting process from the D.C. government and the Secret Service and all that was involved was very difficult. But we still used the D.C. Fire Department, who is really, really terrific. And we took their truck and their ladder onto the South Lawn by the ellipse, and we put that ladder all the way up, and I actually got to go up in it. And just as you heard them describing, and you look down on the most incredible view of the south face of the White House and the whole South Lawn. And that's going to be our cover for the new issue in November. So we're really, really excited about that. It's really a beautiful and special image, and reflects the mirror image of the photograph that was taken from Pennsylvania Avenue for the first guidebook, and was inspired by this very special story that we heard from Bob. Well, they finish the guidebook, and finally the day comes to present it to President and Mrs. Kennedy, and they do so in the Roosevelt Room of the White House. And I just imagine the excitement that's in the air, because Mrs. Kennedy was so enthused about this, and she was really eager to share it with President Kennedy. Tell us what you know about how it was received, and was this a popular item at the time? Was it a successful sales item? And what happened after it was presented to the president?
It was wildly successful right off the bat. 250,000 copies were sold within 90 days. And they had to work immediately to start a second printing. And of course, things were changing at the White House. So revisioning and second printing all happening at the same time. And the new edition sold out. It was told that people came with shopping carts, because we were only charging $1 a copy to buy multiple copies as gifts and souvenirs and all of that sort of thing. Bob talks about people with just sending in $1 in an envelope saying, please send back a White House guidebook. And I think Nash Castro rented a vault in the Riggs Bank. And for people that are not in Washington, there's a very large Riggs Bank right across from the White House and the Treasury. And Nash Castro rented a vault because he couldn't open the mail with the money fast enough. and he had to have a secure place to put it. So it was wildly successful.
So after the first guidebook was published, what was the impact of this very successful project at the National Geographic itself? And what collaboration, if any, continued with the association after that? I understand there may have actually been a fostering of a new department at the National Geographic as a result of this project.
So the impact of this particular project was really unique and big at the National Geographic. It changed some of the ways that the magazine did its storytelling. It also created a whole new division where books of all sorts were done. Most importantly, National Geographic also worked on similar projects for the Capitol Historical Society and for the Supreme Court Historical Society, and a number of other Geographic editors and executives served on those boards as well. The public service work that the Geographic was doing for Washington institutions just became very, very important to what we were doing, and very important, I think, for the city itself.
Well, it was certainly a moment of accomplishment and collaboration with the association and the National Geographic, and for Bob Breeden personally, who, as I mentioned earlier, went on to great leadership accomplishments heading our organization for many years. Bob talked about his work with Mrs. Kennedy at the time, and how did he reflect on that interface with her?
He said it was a pleasure to work with her. And of course, she was one of the few publishing professionals to have also been First Lady, so that helped. He said at one point he accidentally blurted out to her that she was not known to change her mind very easily. And then he realized perhaps that was not quite appropriate. But he said, you know, she smiled. And he did say of all the First Ladies that he worked with, she knew exactly what she wanted the guidebook to be. She knew what she wanted in it. She knew what she wanted for the White House. And she was gentle but firm in insisting that she got what she wanted. So I think he greatly admired her and really appreciated her eye and her own input into the guidebook.
And you know, I think we all should admire and respect Mrs. Kennedy. It's really incredible to me that she was First Lady for such a short period of time, less than 3 years, but so much of what she put in place, not just this guidebook, but the White House Historical Association, what later became the Committee for the Preservation of the White House, the hiring of the first curator. Those are still the systems and the process that is in place today that governs historic preservation at the White House, still today. And it's such an honor for us during our 60th anniversary year to be Mrs. Kennedy's living legacy for historic preservation at the White House and to share the really wonderful, rich history of relationships like we've had and continue to have with the National Geographic. You know, we are just 4 or 5 blocks apart, but we have the ongoing connectivity in so many ways. I know that one of those is that we share governance connectivity. Gene Case, who is chair of your board, serves on our board of directors, and Fred Ryan, who's the chair of our board, serves on the National Geographic board as well. But there are other connections. Share some of that with us.
There are a few other pieces into the White House Geographic history story. One, a very early contributor, the first woman to serve on our board, Eliza Sidmore, worked very closely with First Lady Taft to bring the cherry trees to Washington. And we know how much that transformed the city, particularly down by the tidal basin. Also, there was a writer, photographer, contributor to National Geographic, a woman named Helen Churchill Candee. She had quite a colorful life and career, globetrotting, but she worked as a designer, and she designed chairs that are still, I believe, in the White House collection. One of the other notable things about her is that she was a Titanic survivor. I think she was in the same lifeboat as Molly Brown and Teddy Roosevelt. So President Roosevelt was very much connected to a number of people at the Geographic and authored a few stories. after he was president, when he went on his famous River of Doubt expedition to South America, where he almost died. He was quite sick. When he was finally back in Washington, he gave the first public talk about that experience at the National Geographic Society, but he was still so weak that his voice could barely go above a whisper, and in, you know, several thousand people in an auditorium, not one sound. That's how compelling a story and storyteller he was.
Well, I think our listeners to the 1600 Sessions podcast are going to be very interested in your story. I think you must have one of the best jobs in Washington, if not the country, with all the archival materials and images that you must have at your disposal. And we'd love to just live a little vicariously through you and hear about your job, what it's like, and the wonderful, extraordinary digital assets that you have there at the National Geographic Society.
Well, Stewart, I would think you give me a run for my money on best job in town. So, but yeah, so National Geographic, of course, was founded in 1888. So we have over 130 years of materials, and we're not the Smithsonian in the, you know, millions and millions of artifacts, but we come back with film, photos, and stories and words. So we have over 1 million feet of archival film footage in all sorts of formats and in all states of repair or disrepair. We have almost 12 million photos in the photo archives. We have lantern slides. We have the largest autochrome collection outside of Paris, 35 millimeter. We have space photography on big 75 millimeter that's stored in cans that look like coffee cans. There's also a very large art collection, because there are certain things that you can't photograph. If you're looking for a Mayan marketplace, that's an illustration. So we have a lot of illustration and art in the collection as well. And we have been digitizing it over the last few years. Our goal is to push more of the digital content out to the public to broaden accessibility. We love having people come to see us, but if you have to come into the building and be there in person, it's always going to be very limiting of who can have access to materials. So we're all about pushing materials out to the public.
Well, there's another way that our partnership back in the early 1960s continues to have life today, and that's a collection that we inherited from you, and it was actually down in our basement in our wonderful little series of townhouses that we have on Lafayette Square. And there were these freezers, like home freezers, like you lift up and get food out of at home. Well, these were filled with these frozen, preserved photography negatives. And so we decided that we needed to digitize these. And they were remnants of the early guidebooks that were given to us by National Geographic and kept and preserved in these freezers. And actually, many of these images had never been seen before at all by the public. And so for the past few years, we've been digitizing these thousands and thousands of images, including the metadata that goes with them, and putting those on our digital library as a resource for the public, so that that wonderful partnership that began the guidebook in the early 60s really continues to bear fruit that is beneficial to scholars, students, journalists, and others today. And we're really, really grateful for that.
Stewart, that's so interesting because, of course, the Society is so proud of its work to support the preservation and history of the White House. And I know just being so close to the White House, other staff members and myself, you know, on a beautiful afternoon when you're worried or you have meetings or you're trying to work through a problem, it is very common for us to stroll down 16th Street through Lafayette Park to the White House and back and just make that circuit between our two buildings. And it's sort of just being near the White House, sort of you want to think big thoughts and find the solution to whatever your issue of the day is. So we still find inspiration just being your neighbor.
Well, you know, there is something about the president's neighborhood that makes it a very special place. And as you mentioned, digitization is so important to everything that we do these days. And while there are no actual tours of the White House during this COVID-19 pandemic, The association has created a virtual tour of the White House available to download on the White House Historical Association Experience app. So it's the White House Experience app, and the photography is really extraordinary. It's 360 degrees of those beautiful staterooms, the East Room, State Dining Room, Red Room, Green Room, Blue Room, and others. But the printed guidebook is still incredibly popular, and that has stood the test of time. Next November, we'll be publishing the 25th edition of this guidebook, and I hope everyone will come back and get a copy of that when it is released. Well, thank you so much for joining us today and for walking us through the early history of our White House Historical Association and that iconic White House guidebook that Bob Breeden was so instrumental in creating and his colleagues at the National Geographic in working with him and with Mrs. Kennedy and with the White House Historical Association.
Well, thank you, Stewart. And I'm looking forward to later this year when your 60th celebration can kick into high gear, and hopefully I will see you around the Decatur House with a glass of champagne in your hand.
Well, I can't wait for that. So cheers to that moment, and I look forward to it as well. And to our listeners and viewers of this podcast, as always, it's wonderful to have you with us for this episode of the 1600 Sessions. Remember, you can look at previous episodes or listen to them on our website, and you can also learn more about the White House Historical Association and support our work as a nonprofit, nonpartisan organization by going to our website, whitehousehistory.org. Thank you.